Okay, Matt, would you like to explain to everyone how the... Why are you laughing? It's because of my intro.
Yes. So, as a reminder, if you didn't see the last video, EMC stands for Electromagnetic Compatibility. So I always used to get that wrong. I used to think it was compliance because you've got to pass a test, but it's actually... The test is to see if you're compatible. So CE says that for electromagnetic compatibility, your emissions have to be below a certain point. And you might have heard that I have been struggling with the EMC, especially the unintended emissions. You can see all my reports here. We've had lots of different tests, and we've always had these problems where at a certain frequency or few frequencies, we end up being way over the margin. So this is the limit, sorry. The limit is this darker line, and then the margin is this lower line. If you can make something that is below the limits, then that's fine, you can pass. But really, you also want to be below the margin, because different test facilities have different setups, and you might pass in one but fail in another. So I want the products, I want the keyboard to be way below the limits, and that has been the challenge. And I've gone down lots of rabbit holes trying to thinking like what these things are. And one of the most difficult parts is that I thought that this main frequency here was a multiple of the clock frequency, the microcontroller in the left and the right side. But that turned out to be a complete red herring. And I spent a lot of time trying to work out why the clock would make so much noise, because especially we've got an internal oscillator on these keyboards. It's not even an external one. And then I found out that it's actually the LED driver. So that was the huge breakthrough that I had maybe 3 weeks ago. I kind of made this exploded version of the right-hand side, where I took the LED driver off the board and put it onto this little breakout board here, and then wired all the wires back to all the LED matrix, so that I could more easily check with a magnetic field sensor attached to my scope what was going on. And I found out that it's actually the switching frequency of the LED PWM that is generating all this noise. So I made a set of plug-in filters so I can filter the lines and try some different things and put pretty much all the recommendations into the new PCB design. So filters, common mode chokes, more ferrites, more decoupling capacitors, fatter power traces, better layout. We're only using a two-layer board, so I can't really use ground planes. That probably would have helped a lot. One of the reasons why this is so long is because every time you do this process is you have to make the PCB and then wait for it to arrive and then assemble it and then book a test, because the test rooms are big and expensive. And then we tested it, and this is the latest results. So this was what it used to be like here. This is what Manel's computer looks like on its own in the test chamber without any keyboard. And now this is what our keyboard looks like when it's plugged into Manel's keyboard in the test chamber. So you can't even see that it's there anymore. Unfortunately, I don't have enough time to experiment to know exactly what I changed that fixed it. So that's annoying to not have a full understanding. But I'm fairly sure it's either the common mode choke, the better power layout, or the more decoupling. And probably a lot of people are asking, why didn't you do this before? And that's a really great question. So James Pawson at Unit 3, I got him to do a design review, and he gave us back loads of useful information, which I integrated into the board. And the thing that I should have done after that is to then pay for have it tested in a chamber, because then I would have known that we actually had these problems, instead of only finding out in September, October last year. And I still don't know exactly why I didn't do that. I think it was a misguided attempt to save money, because it costs a lot of money to do these tests. So I thought, okay, I'll just follow what he says in the design review and it'll be fine. But it actually wasn't fine. Honk. Wrong. So yeah, next time. And I've read this great, as part of my understanding, I've read this fantastic book, which is called Electromagnetic Compatibility by Henry Ott. And one of the first things he says is, when you make your design, design for EMC right at the beginning. So that would be my my advice and guidance for anyone starting out on this process who's not done it before, like me, this is my first time doing it, that you need to pay attention to this at the very beginning. Do the design review and do the pre-certification as early in the process as you can. And it's a false economy to not do the real test as early as possible. So learn from my mistakes.